Okay, so the purpose of this talk is to give you a fast forward from Gilad's talk, which is the first feasibility result in an area, to the state of the art in one frontier. There are several frontiers. This is not the state of the art, but it gives us one setting of parameters for which are well motivated, and this talk will give you pretty much the best we can do. So, before getting to the talk, yesterday I intended to do it, but didn't get to the final slide, so this is an advertisement. This is like a recurring, how many times did it take place already? This is, I think maybe, yeah, so this is an annual workshop that usually takes place in Denmark, and you're all invited to submit papers. The deadline is submit proposals for contributed talks. The deadline is soon, 25. Okay, so we're going, I'm continuing directly the same setting that Gilad talked about, general MPC with an honest majority. Compared to the competition of dishonest majority, you know, we also have protocols for dishonest majority, we have the following advantages. We can get unconditional security, we do not need to rely on assumptions, on unproven assumptions. Information theoretic security, we can get these features of guaranteed output delivery and fairness that are typically impossible to get when we have no honest majority. We can get nice composability properties with no setup, but the focus of all these are very nice features, but the main purpose of this talk is to show you that these protocols can also be efficient, much more efficient than the protocol you saw in the previous talk. So recall the two feasibility results. The first was shown by Gilad, and the second he mentioned in the end of the talk. And our goal is to minimize the complexity of such protocols, and we will be interested, or in general, people are interested in three main efficiency features. One is communication complexity, the second is computation complexity, how much local computation is performed by each party, and the third is the round complexity, how many times do the parties need to talk to each other. Okay, so let me start by telling you what we cannot do or what seem to be barriers that would require new ideas. So ideally, we want security to be for free, right? We want secure computation and insecure computation, insecure distributed computation to be as efficient. We're quite far from this goal. So what do we get in reality? First of all, in the information theoretic setting, we have this circuit size barrier. We saw it in the previous BGW protocol that it takes a gate by gate approach and there is a communication for every gate. Okay, so there are some exceptions, actually interesting exceptions. One exception is structured computations. For instance, linear algebra computations, we can do them, I don't know, a matrix product, we can do it with communication which is comparable to the size of the matrices, whereas it's open to do it with this much computation, right? So there are structured problems for which we can get better communication than the circuit size. Of course, we don't know the actual circuit size, I'm always referring to the best known circuit size. Perhaps an even more interesting example is related to the talk on PIR, the talks on private information retrieval you heard on the first and second day. And you can actually convert state-of-the-art PIR protocols into honest majority protocols, or specifically in the three-party case, you can get a protocol that applies to every function on input X. X is the concatenated inputs of all parties, where the communication complexity you might expect it to be 2 to the power of the length of X, which is roughly the best circuit size for the worst function. Okay, most functions cannot be computed by circuits that are much smaller than this. However, we can get this quadratic savings in the exponent. Okay, this is super polynomial improvement in communication complexity. over what you would get by running the protocol that Gilad described. So this we get using these non-trivial techniques that I explained at the high level and Klim gave the details. And this suggests that at the high end, we do break this circuit size barrier. However, it's only at the high, very high end. The types of circuits we typically want to compute are polynomial in the input size, and for such circuits, it's a fascinating question to get any improvement. So we do not know. It feels like there should be a way to combine this high-end solution with low-end solutions, but we don't know how to do it. So that's an interesting challenge, but at this point, this is where we stand. So at this point, for general circuits that say are polynomial in the size of the input, we do not have any technique in the information theoretic setting that gets us below the circuit size in terms of communication complexity. So this will be our baseline. Computation, the best we can hope for is a constant computational overhead. You can measure computational overhead by comparing, say, the size of a Boolean or arithmetic circuit representing the function to the size of a circuit representing the parties in the protocol. Look at each party in the protocol as a circuit in the same model, either Boolean or arithmetic, and look at the total size of all circuits representing the parties, and the overhead is the circuit size of the parties divided by the circuit size of the function. We can't expect the overhead to be one, but we can expect it to be a constant. We cannot get it to be a constant when the number of parties or the security threshold is big. The reason is, if you look at Gilad's description of the BGW protocol, even in the simplest setting, we need to do Shamir secret sharing. Shamir secret sharing requires multi-point evaluation of a polynomial. We do not know how to do it in linear time, only in quasi-linear time. So this is really, so you can ask, okay, maybe I can use better error correcting codes. We do have asymptotically good codes that are linear time encodable. However, these codes do not have the right type of property that the multiplication property that is implicitly used by the BGW protocol. So we do not know of any approach that can give us constant computational overhead when the security threshold is big. However, when you have three parties in the passive case or four parties in the active case, the BGW protocol does have a constant computational overhead. So with constant number of parties or constant security threshold, we can get constant overhead. And finally, there is this big open question again about information theoretic MPC, about getting constant round protocols for all polynomial time computable functions. So here it's a question, we can get such protocols if we don't care at all about communication complexity, but if we do want the communication complexity to be polynomial in the size of the input, that's a big open question of getting constant round protocols for all polynomial time computable functions. What we do get from the protocols in the style that Gilad described is round complexity that is proportional to the depth of the circuit, or more accurately, the length of the number of multiplications on the longest, on the biggest number of multiplications on a path from an input to an output. That's the round complexity of typical protocols. We can shave a bit and we can get constant round protocols for some, for a rich class of functions, and Benny will talk about that. And these limitations or these points about getting stuck apply even for the easiest setting, even for passive security, even when you allow the threshold to be much less than the optimal one. Okay, even if T is one and N is a million, still the same barriers hold. Okay, cool. So now the question is, can we do better? This is just for reference, right? We're talking about information theoretic security. What about the computational setting? It is a very mainstream setting in cryptography. And let's look at the two-party case. What can we do in the two-party case? Okay, so here I already mentioned the tools of fully homomorphic encryption and homomorphic secret sharing, that they do allow us to get below the circuit size barrier. So from an asymptotic point of view, if you're willing to make standard cryptographic assumptions, we can get communication complexity to be almost as good as we can expect. That's asymptotically. However, concretely, information theoretic protocols will often still do much better. So for computations that are not too complex, still the lean nature of information theoretic MPC will make it perform better, typically in terms of communication as well. But asymptotically, computational setting wins. Things are even more extreme in the context of round complexity. Here we can use even very mild computational assumptions via the garbled circuit techniques to get the round complexity to be optimal. But in terms of computational cost, the information theoretic setting is better. So under some, I would say, not too wild assumptions, we can get constant overhead in the two-party setting in the passive security model. However, this is open for the active security model unless you consider arithmetic circuits over big fields. So for arithmetic circuits over big fields, under the right assumptions, we can get constant computational overhead in the two-party setting. What I view as a kind of a very elusive question that I think by now quite a few people thought about is to get a result of constant computational overhead with active security for Boolean circuits. Okay, so you want to compute a Boolean circuit of size S, and you want the parties to be implemented by a Boolean circuit of size 100 times S. So that's a challenge, and again, the difficulty seems to come from similar sources that we had in the previous, in the information theoretic setting, where T is big. Okay, so what can we realistically hope for? Again, nothing I said so far is set in stone. This is just what the current techniques we have give us. But now my question is, what can we realistically hope to get given the current techniques? Okay, or without breaking any of the these barriers that I mentioned before. So what we can hope to get is to use as a baseline the best known complexity for the easy case of passive security. Now we're back to the information theoretic setting. So easy case of passive security against one party with a constant number of parties. Okay, this is the easiest setting from an asymptotic point of view. Right, you can use as few as three parties, or maybe it helps you to use more parties. And now we want to get the same total cost, not the same cost per party, for active security. So this is typically much more difficult, you saw in Gilad's talk. And we also want the number of parties to be big, without losing the optimal security threshold. So we basically want to get something that's more challenging on two frontiers, on two fronts. One is active versus passive, and the second is scaling well with the number of parties without increasing the total cost, okay, not the cost per party. So this is our goal. We want it to be while maintaining, we want to achieve it while maintaining optimal resilience. Depending on the setting, it can be T less than N over 2 or T less than N over 3. And again, now I'm spelling out just what we know in the setting on the right, and this is our goal on the setting in the left. So we want the total communication complexity to be circuit size times a constant. We want the computational overhead. I said we cannot get constant, so let's settle for polylog. And round complexity, we're not hoping to get here anything better. So we're fine with using the same number of rounds as before. Okay, so what can we get, actually? This will be what I will describe in this talk. So we can actually get it with a few relatively small caveats. One caveat is that we need to lose a bit in the security threshold. So instead of getting optimal security, here we will settle for near optimal security. So depending on the setting, think of something slightly less than one-third, something slightly less than one-half. The more you are far away from optimal, the better the constants are. So it's not like for free trying to get very close to optimal. But asymptotics will not be affected by how close you are to the threshold. Communication complexity, we will get what we want, assuming that the circuit is typical. So we want, first of all, the circuit that we're computing to be much bigger than the number of parties. And we also don't want the circuit to be skinny and very deep. So if you want to evaluate something like iterating a hash function many, many times, you can only do it optimally if the number of parties is smaller than the size of the part you're iterating. So basically, for almost all circuits we want to evaluate, these conditions hold. Computation, we will get polylog overhead and even logarithmic overhead for the arithmetic model, and rounds will be as before. Okay, so this is really capturing what we can get, and I'll give you most of the details on how to do it. But again, we're taking the simplest possible setting in the information theoretic case and somehow upgrading it to the most challenging setting without paying anything, almost anything, in the total cost. Okay, a few points about, I guess, this caveat of losing a bit in the resilience. So first, there is a recent lower bound of Damgaard et al. That shows that at least in the low end, if you look at simple functions, we need to pay this price. So if you insist on optimal security, you can show some simple functions for which you actually need to pay an overhead that is linear in the number of parties, even in the communication, let alone computation. Okay, so this compromise is necessary. But I would like to argue that it's not such a bad compromise, especially when the number of parties is big. It seems like a good trade-off in practice and in theory, and in fact, when you consider storing information, right? Error-correcting codes, typically people do not employ a repetition code despite this code having optimal resilience, right? Instead of repetition code, people say, okay, I will use a much better code in terms of information rate, and we lose a bit in resilience. That's a common practice in coding, and when you consider MPC with many parties, there is no special reason to do otherwise. And finally, my second talk will be about applications of these kinds of protocols, the so-called MPC in the head approach, which is almost insensitive to the security threshold. So for these applications, you really don't care about, it just changes a bit in the parameters. You don't even pay a price for using a smaller security threshold. So these are the reasons why this near optimal regime can be viewed as being very reasonable. Okay, so for the purpose of this talk, I will make several simplifying assumptions to the point that the protocol I will describe is simpler, even though it's more efficient, it's simpler than the last protocol that Gilad described. The main source of the multiple reasons why the protocol is simpler. Okay, one is just an issue of optimizing efficiency is easier when the inputs originate from a constant number of parties that are called clients. I will explain this model in more detail later, but it's basically a client-server model where we have many servers that do the computation, but the inputs and outputs, they only come from a constant number of parties that we refer to as clients. We are okay with security with abort, which makes things considerably simpler. Security with abort allows the adversary to mount a denial of service attack. That's okay, that's legitimate. The honest parties can say, hey, something went wrong, I don't want to continue. In the BGW protocol, the second version, active security version that Gilad described, the goal is to get guaranteed output delivery. We are settling here for statistical security as opposed to perfect security against static, non-adaptive adversary. The adversary is still active. We will consider small fractional resilience. I will just sketch how we move from small to near optimal. And we also assume broadcast, which can be eliminated. The same result holds even if you only have point-to-point channels. Okay, so all these assumptions are for simplicity and they can be eliminated at almost no cost, at least from an asymptotic point of view. Okay, so a bit in more detail, this is the client-server model. It's a very realistic model in many situations. We have these clients who want to perform secure computation on their inputs using N servers. So think of N as big. Again, it's motivated by MPC in the head type applications that I will talk about next. And also, I should say, as before, that this model is just convenience and we can get essentially the same results also in the standard M-party model. Okay, in the communication model, we assume point-to-point channels, but also only want servers to talk to clients. We don't want server-to-server communication. You can imagine that if there is server-to-server communication, this will cause some quadratic blow-up that we want to avoid. So in the BGW protocol, there was this quadratic blow-up. Here, we don't want it. So servers only talk to clients. And again, this is just being more specific. We consider this fractional security threshold, which is not necessarily close to optimal. And importantly, the active adversary can corrupt any number of clients, so no honest majority of clients. There's just an honest majority of servers. The adversary can corrupt any subset of the clients and some small fraction of the servers. Okay, and we still want this adversary to not learn anything about and not influence anything for the other clients that are not corrupted. Any questions about the model? How much time do I have? Good. And again, security here is statistical security with abort. Okay, so this is just also for your reference, this is just a small part of the vast literature on efficient, honest majority MPC. The top bunch, and there is a lot of really nice ideas from these papers that influence papers below them, but let me explain each category. The top category includes papers that try to specifically to optimize mainly communication complexity of MPC with many parties, but subject to exactly optimal security thresholds. So T less than N over 2 and T less than N over 3. And this applies to the standard MPC model. And as I said, we have this barrier, that barrier of our techniques, but in a sense it's fundamental also, at least for small circuits, that we must pay a price, an overhead, even in communication, let alone computation, which is linear in the number of parties, okay? So this is really the baseline for all these protocols. They're trying to get to this baseline. What I will talk about is, it's mainly joint work with Ivan Damgaard, later some more, I would say, general version with Manoj and Amit, where we have this client-server model that I described, and we are okay with near-optimal resilience. Okay, and this has the unique feature that the total communication and computation scale well with the number of parties. They do not. We do not pay. We pay at most a logarithmic or polylog price. Okay, so we have a distinction in the arithmetic case. It's logarithmic. In the Boolean case, there is some additional statistical parameter that only comes in the computation cost and not in the communication cost. And the bottom works, they kind of get similar results with near optimal resilience, but in the standard MPC model, namely not with a constant number of clients, but with any number of clients. Okay, so I will talk about the middle type of results. Okay, these are some other papers, mainly ones that introduce techniques that I will rely on. So there is the idea of bracha that came in the context of Byzantine agreement that shows how to boost the security threshold in a generic way. So this is something that will help us move from small fractional security threshold to near optimal security. There is the idea of Franklin and Jung of a packed secret sharing. I think that Gilad mentioned it on his first talk on secret sharing. This allows us really to move beyond, not to be wasteful in how we share secrets, right? Sharing one secret at a time is very wasteful. There is the work of Chen and Kramer that helps us get constant communication overhead for Boolean circuits via the use of algebraic geometry codes. This is less relevant if you worry about, if you care about arithmetic computations over big fields. And there is the work of Araki et al., which is a representative of a very popular line of work, which is very different from what I will talk about. This line of work tries to optimize concrete efficiency of protocols with a very small number of parties, 3, 5, and so on. And we'll hear about it from Niv later today. Okay, so let me recall what we just saw in Gilad's talk, how the BGW or CCD protocol work. They have these three phases. In the first phase, you use Shamir secret sharing to secret share the inputs. So in our case, we can think of the clients doing it. So each client takes every input. Think of the input as a field element. The size of the field has to be bigger than the number of servers, and now each client uses Shamir secret sharing to share the input between the servers. And it has a degree T. Now we evaluate the circuit on the shares. Normally we would do it by having the servers talk to each other. This is what we saw in the last talk. And then we get shares of the, so the key property of Shamir secret sharing is that we can do this local multiplication of two shared secrets. So if we do a pointwise multiplication of the shares, we get a polynomial of degree 2t whose free coefficient encodes the product of x and y, the two secrets. Okay, an addition is for free, doesn't require interaction. For multiplication, we need interaction to reduce the degree back to T so that we can keep multiplying. And finally, we recover the outputs. This is just done by having the servers send shares of the outputs to the clients. So this is secure, as we just saw, less than n over 2 in the passive case, less than n over 3 in the active case. In the passive case, the complexity of the straightforward implementation of BGW would be quadratic in the number of parties. In the active case, it will be much more. They did not try to optimize it. So Gilad, you know the version you described? What is the asymptotic communication? What? N to the 6, okay. Yeah, in any case, it was not, there was a line of work optimizing it. I doubted the original BGW or CCD tried really to optimize asymptotics. In theory papers, sometimes the bigger the polynomial, the better, so. No, it's not the best. There is a line of work that reduces this overhead of poly N down to N. Specifically, let me mention, because I will not mention these works again, in the passive case, this was done in a work by Damgaard and Nielsen, and in the active case, this was done by a work of Berliova and Hirt. And this is with T in the perfect active case. In the statistical active case with T less than N over 2, a work of Ben Sasson, Fair, and Ostrovsky. But there's a line of subsequent works that improve various aspects of these protocols. Okay, what are the sources of overhead, right? Why do we have this big polynomial overhead? Well, first, each wire value is split into n shares. We, just before even doing any computation, we already lose a factor of n in the communication. So to get around it, we just use packed secret sharing. I'll explain how it's done, but this is a really natural extension of Shamir. Here also, we already pay some price in resilience. Okay, so here we already lose optimal resilience. Then there is this point about the servers talking to each other for each multiplication. This again gives us some quadratic communication cost for every gate. So even if we do the packing, we will still have a linear overhead that we want to get rid of. And finally, verification, right? The VSS is quite complicated and uses expensive machinery. Okay, so these are the three sources of overhead. And we'll get really, so I didn't say it explicitly, the second source of overhead, we get around it using an approach where we use a client. Again, it's an approach that was taken also in distributed computing, where instead of, we basically will reveal at every point, we'll pick one client and let this client not trust this client, but reveal to this client some masked version of an intermediate value of the computation and ask this client to rearrange and reshare. Okay, and this client will have to prove that he did things correctly. We will not trust the client, but we will still use the help of this special client to reduce the cost. And for the efficient consistency checks, we will use batch verification techniques. Okay, so this is very generic, and many works along this line use similar techniques. However, the implementation details vary from one setting to the other. Okay, let me start with share packing. We already saw it, so I'll do it very briefly. So this is a standard Shamir secret sharing. You encode the secret X as the free coefficient as a polynomial. And here you can just think of these additional negative evaluation points that encode additional secrets. So we will denote by W the number of field elements that we secret shared together. And note that here, still each party, so each party will still get the points on the right of the y-axis. Okay, however, we do need now more parties to reconstruct, right? We will get higher degree if we want the same privacy threshold. So basically the security threshold, if we keep the degree D, in the normal Shamir, the security threshold T is equal to the degree, right? If the degree of the polynomial is one, we get security against a single party. Here we lose W minus one. Okay, just because we encode more information, so you have these additional constraints. It's a straightforward exercise to show it. However, if this block size is, say, n over 10, where n is the number of servers, then we do get an omega n savings for small security loss. So we lose 10% of the parties, but we get, in return, a linear savings in communication, just for the secret sharing. Okay, and again, this is totally analogous to what people do in the context of error correcting codes. Okay, and just for notation, we will use this square bracket surrounding a vector to denote a packed secret sharing of the vector with the subscript D denoting the degree of the sharing. These are the degree of the polynomials that are used to share. The security threshold will be D minus W plus one. Okay, so let's try to apply really out of the box BGW, but using packed secret sharing. What can and what we cannot do? Okay, and this was really the proposal of Franklin and Jung. So we can do so-called SIMD-friendly computation. So SIMD is single instruction multiple data. It's basically doing component-wise operation, addition or multiplication in our case, on vectors. So in the same way that we were able to add Shamir shares and multiply Shamir shares using interaction, we can do it with packed shares at the same cost. Okay, we only lose in resilience, we don't pay anything more in communication. So if we have the same circuit evaluated on three different inputs, we can perform it using just blocks of size three, where, you know, if we want to think of this as a multiplication gate, we just do pointwise product of these two blocks, and then we handle the same multiplication gate for all sets of inputs simultaneously. Okay, so this we can do. What we cannot do is take a single arbitrary computation and divide the inputs into blocks, because now it's all over the place. We cannot evaluate this single circuit on these blocks using pointwise operations. Okay, so let's see as a warm-up a very simple case for evaluating, you know, with now until further notice the adversary is passive. And this toy example represents a depth one circuit. So we have a single layer of gates. There are these clients A and B, so each client contributes either the left or the right value of each gate. And the third client, C, wants to learn the output of this computation. So how do we do it with packed secret sharing? Note that this is not an SIMD-friendly computation because the wiring here is all over the place. So as is, if you look at the inputs as written and you just put them into block in the order they're written, this will not work. However, since the client know the topology of the circuit, they know which inputs feed into which gate, they can replicate the inputs into blocks in the right way, in the helpful way. So they just put, you know, replicate inputs here. This is the multiplication gates. Let me bring them back so that you see. These are the blocks for the multiplication gates. And the client A will just set up his inputs according to the gate. So A1 is the left input of the first multiplication gate. A2 is the first input of the second multiplication gate, and A2 happens to be also the first input of the third multiplication gate. And the green stuff is what client B does. And now once they arrange their inputs into blocks in the right replication pattern, then we can perform the computation using just pointwise operations, pointwise multiplication or pointwise addition. So essentially the clients here are helping convert the computation into SIMD computation by arranging values correctly into blocks. Okay, and this is the full protocol. It's really like a BGW style protocol. We do need these blinding values. Let me just remind you that in the BGW protocol, if we just do multiplication of Shamir shares of two secrets, we don't get a random secret sharing of the output. This, in particular, this polynomial can be factored, right? It's not a random polynomial of degree 2t. So we have these blinding values that are also contributed by the clients, and the servers do these pointwise multiplication or addition of their shares. And then in the case of multiplication, we need to re-randomize the polynomial, but we do it by just adding random shares of a block of zeros. So this 0, 2D, these are blinding blocks or masking blocks of zeros that are contributed by both clients, and they're being added to the shares of the products to eliminate all information except the product. Okay, if you take some degree 2T polynomial that encodes a block and you add a random polynomial that encodes a block of zeros, you get a random polynomial that encodes the output. Okay, so this is really the full protocol using the previous notation. A question, why do both clients, suppose that the blinding values are only contributed by, say, client A, why do we need client B to also contribute these blinding values? Okay, suppose that we remove ZB from the server's message. So server doesn't use this blinding polynomial contributed by B. What can go wrong? The issue is that now if client C colludes with client A, they can unmask the blinding of A and therefore expose more than the output. Okay, so we need to, let me remind you that we consider any number of corrupted clients, not just one in this case. Okay, and we can do it for any constant degree polynomial in one shot, right? So you can, instead of multiplying two things, you can multiply five things if you are fine with reducing the resilience proportionally to the degree. So this is similar to the notion of homomorphic secret sharing that I described 2 days ago. Okay, so this works, and this will have the efficiency features that we want. But it's limited to circuits that have just one layer, and the challenge in these cases is how to handle the transition from one layer to another when the circuit is not too repetitive. It doesn't have a nice SIMD friendliness property. Okay, that's a challenge. So this is the details. I will not walk you through the full details. I will just give you an example, but let me give you the high-level idea. So the high-level idea is something I mentioned before. For each intermediate layer in the computation, it's arranged into blocks. We cannot reveal these intermediate values to anyone, but we take the first client, he's the king, and we reveal to the first client a masked version of the block. Okay, that's okay, it's masked with randomness that nobody knows. And now we use this single client to do the reconstruction. Okay, first it reconstructs the masked block. Now it needs to feed it into the next layer, but it has to take the pattern of the circuit, the topology of the circuit into account. But it's a single client, so it can locally, it knows the circuit topology is public, so it can just split these masked values and rearrange them into blocks in the replicated way that will set up the computation for the next layer. Okay, if the client is passively corrupted, then there is no concern here, right? Because the values are masked, so he doesn't learn anything, and he does what the protocol tells him. We'll need to ensure that the malicious clients will still do what they're supposed to, but for now, we are in the setting of a passive corruption. Okay, so the question is, how do you do the unmasking? Because in order to continue, so if I get a bunch of masked blocks, and I now rearrange them for the next layer so that I rearrange and then reshare it between the servers, they're still masked. So how do we do the unmasking? Right, that's a challenge. And the answer is that we just need to generate random blocks with corresponding replication that matches what we're supposed to do when we move from one layer to another. I will show an example of how this works, but essentially the only challenge here is to ensure that we have an unmasking that is compatible with the rearrangement of blocks. And this is done by generating special type of correlated randomness that involves shared random blocks and versions of them that are permuted and replicated according to the circuit topology. So this is really the resource that we have to consume here in order to get the process going. So let's see an example. Okay, so we start when we have the inputs of the bottom gate. So this is, say, in the notation of the previous protocol, this is layer H, and this is layer H plus 1. So we start when we have packed secret sharing of two blocks, the left inputs of the red gates and the right inputs of the red gates. This is our starting point. The type of correlated randomness that we set up here, or you can think of it as shared blocks that satisfy of random values, but the random values are replicated in a certain way, it will have the following pattern. So these are the masks of the values of these red gates. Okay, these are used to protect them when we reveal them to the client, the special client. But now the special client is supposed to take every value, mass value, and put it in the right slots of the blocks that feed into these addition gates of the next layer. So we want to mimic this by also generating blocks of randomness that will follow the same type of replication pattern. So let me just explain how this looks like. What is the R1, R1, R2, R3? What does it come from? It comes from the fact that if you look at the left input of the green gates, they're taken from the first, the second, and the third red gates. Okay, so this is just setting up, this is how the computation should be set up for the green layer to do the pointwise additions. But we do it on the randomness, why? Because now, let's see how this works. This is what the special client gets. He gets these mass values y1, y2, y3, y4. They do not reveal the values of the red gates. Now, he needs to reconstruct these values, arrange them into blocks that feed into the green layer, and reshare. So now, in order to perform the computation blockwise, the rearrangement has to follow this pattern, the same pattern. So these are just the values that are fed into the left input of each gate, and these are the values that are fed into the right input of each green gate. And if we add these y's together, what do we get? We don't get the values of the green gates, we get the mass values of the green gates. Okay? But now we have the right type of unmasking because we have the randomness rearranged according to the same pattern. So it's just doing some kind of a replication pattern that will undo the mask after the values have been rearranged. That's it. So if I wasn't clear enough, just think about it and look at the formal description of the protocol. Okay, now when we can do the unmasking, and we're back to, we maintain the invariant that we have a block containing the left values and a block containing the right values, and we can add them up and we're good. Okay, so I hope this was kind of clear, and now let me explain how we move from passive security to active security. So now we want to worry about both malicious servers, but we have a minority of malicious servers and any number of malicious clients. Malicious servers are actually easy to handle via error correction. This was the easy case that Gilad referred to in the active security case. So if you have a small number of malicious servers, and here we're not in the hard regime, here we're in the easy regime of T less than N over 4, there is enough redundancy to apply error correction of Reed Solomon codes and recover from the malicious server that send. Of course, I'm assuming that everything up to a certain point was correct. If a malicious server starts acting and sends the incorrect things, this can be error corrected. Again, this is easier when T is less than N over 4 than when T is less than N over 3. So we're taking advantage here of suboptimal resilience. And in fact, because we only care here about security with abort, then we don't even need error correction. It's enough to do error detection, which is much easier. Okay, checking that values lie on a polynomial is much easier than correcting them to the right polynomial. And malicious clients will be handled by efficient VSS procedures that will be described next. Okay, so now, basically, we use error correction to ensure that if the clients are behaving, then a small fraction of bad servers can't make anything fail, except abort, denial of service attack. This is what they can do. And now we need to worry about malicious clients, and this will be described next. So now I'm going to describe a much simpler version of VSS protocols that we saw before from Gilad. And the price we pay is that they only give us statistical security and only give us security with abort. So they're not resilient to denial of service. And we actually need two types of VSS-like procedures. One is to verify that shares of a block are consistent with some block. More abstractly, we can think of it as some distributed protocol for verifying that if each of us holds a field element, we want to verify that our joint elements lie in some fixed publicly known linear subspace of F to the N. And the second and seemingly more tricky verification is that even if we're sure that some valid values have been shared, in a block format, we need to ensure that the client, this is the special client that is supposed to replicate things in a proper way in the blocks, we want to check that the replication pattern is indeed correct. Okay, I'm supposed to take, say, the first value that I reconstructed and put it in the second position of the first block in the third position of the fifth block. Right, so the second verification procedure will check that I did this very efficiently. Okay, and here again, we also take advantage of the fact that we amortize the cost over many verifications. This is where statistical security comes very handy. Okay, so how do we verify membership in a linear space? So again, the input is distributed between many servers, and the servers want to be convinced that their inputs jointly form a vector in a linear space, say, shares of a low-degree polynomial, points on a low-degree polynomial. But we have the client, right? So VSS, when we deal with VSS, we have a client that did the sharing. This can either be an input client sharing her input, or it can be the special client who does this resharing in every phase of the computation. Okay, so we're actually in a situation where we can use a zero-knowledge proof, a form of a distributed zero-knowledge proof that we'll hear more about from Niv. But this is a very easy case of a distributed zero-knowledge proof. And the goal, let's say that I am client A, and I distributed the vector V between all of you, and I claim that your joint shares, they lie on a low-degree polynomial. And you tell me, prove it to us, right? You cannot exchange these values because they will reveal the secrets. So you want me to prove to you in zero knowledge that indeed I shared the values consistently with a low degree polynomial. So the way it's done is very simple and very natural and used all over the place. We do it in the following way. I share another vector, u, which I claim to be in the linear space. So I claim, hey, this extra u is also a low-degree polynomial. Why do I do it? For zero knowledge. It doesn't help soundness, so it's not convincing to you, but it's in my benefit to make this vector random and make it in the space. This is for my sake, for the secrecy of my input. Now, a second client, okay, you're the servers. A second client who wants to challenge me broadcasts some random field element C. And the servers do this linear combination. V is the value we want to verify, is the vector we want to verify, and U is the blinding vector that I provided. So each server locally computes his part of the scalar C times the vector V. Okay, C is a global scalar, it's public, but C times VI plus UI, that's what the I server computes and sends to the verifier B. And the verifier B checks that all these WI jointly, they're good. They are in the linear space. Okay, so this type of simple test is sound, and we'll show it, but let's first argue zero knowledge. Why is it zero knowledge? Just because if U is random in the space, then no matter what C and V are, CV plus U is just distributed randomly in the space, and I'm not trying to hide the space. It's a public linear space, so these values, the W vector, does not reveal any information to the verifier B. What about soundness? So here, we crucially rely on the fact that there is static corruption. I will mention soon what we do in the adaptive case, but here we crucially rely on static corruption. And the point is that if there is static corruption, then the identity of the honest servers does not depend on the challenge. This is crucial for this analysis. So now if I look at the messages sent by honest servers, there are malicious servers that want to help the prover cheat. I don't care about these malicious provers because there are too few of them. They cannot move. If the linear space has good enough minimal distance between two vectors, like in a Reed-Solomon code, then malicious servers cannot help make the verification pass. So I just consider the analysis by looking at the values WI returned by honest servers. And now, I'm pretty sure that anyone doing crypto has seen these things in many contexts. And I would like to argue that if V is not in the linear, if the input V is not in the linear space, then no matter what U is, there is at most one C that will make the check pass. And the reason is the following. Suppose that I have two scalars C and C prime. These are the random challenges, right? Two random challenges that make this, the test pass, namely CV plus U and C prime V plus U are both in the linear space. Then by linearity, we know that also C minus C prime V are in the linear space, so it means that V is in the linear space. Or if you take the equivalent form, if V is not in the linear space, you cannot have two distinct C and C prime that pass the test. So the soundness error here is at most one in over the field size. Okay, so this is very clean and simple analysis that gives you what you expect. It turns out, I will soon mention the adaptive security case, but first let me show the amortized version. So it's crucial, this test is still quite expensive, but we want to amortize the cost of this test over checking multiple vectors V. So now I want to check all vectors VI together that they lie in the space, so I just use a single U to blind all of them. And we have now, instead of a single random challenge, we have one scalar for each vector. So it's basically, think of it as a matrix vector product or a random linear combination of the vectors. And the servers compute this random linear combination, which is public, and return a single vector W. So the communication cost of this proof is the same as before, but it's amortized over many blocks. It's almost the same as before. We still have a bigger number of scalars, but first the scalars are cheaper than the vectors, but also we don't really need the two issues. First of all, who generates these challenges? So the naive version would say that each client acts separately as a verifier, but we can actually have some coin tossing generate these challenges jointly. And why does it help us? Because now we can use some combinatorial pseudo-random generator to generate small number of bits that can be stretched into a long vector of scalars that make this test pass. So we just need pseudo-random generators that fool linear functions. Those are known in the Boolean case as epsilon-biased PRGs, and they exist unconditionally. You can take, for instance, some random value and take different powers of the random value. This is a way to de-randomize these constants. Okay, for the case of adaptive security, it's trickier than it seems, and we still do not have a tight analysis of the adaptive case. And in fact, it turns out to be necessary for applications like efficient zero-knowledge proofs that I will talk about in the next slide. So we have made a major step towards a tight analysis of the adaptive security case in this Ligero work that I will mention in the next talk. Okay, how do we verify that the vectors satisfy replication pattern? Again, we use the power of random linear combinations. So what is the challenge? The challenge is, I am the special client. I secret shared these replicated values in the blocks, and I want to convince you that all of the blue values are identical and all of the red values are identical, because this is what I was supposed to do. So how do we do it? Okay, so I want to convince you that A is equal to B is equal to E is equal to G is equal to H, and C is equal to D is equal to F. So first, we write it as a system of linear equations, right? That just two values that are supposed to be equal, we use transitivity of equality here. So we have a linear number of equations, simple equations, and now how do we verify many equations jointly? We just take a random linear combination, just like we did before. So now we have this random linear combination of the values that are inside the blocks that should evaluate to zero. How do we compute? And these are public values. How do we compute it? First of all, we bring it into a canonical form, which is an inner product of the vector of secrets, A to H, with a vector of public values, pub 1, pub 2, which are broken into blocks. So it's basically just some linear combination of the secret values, which you can write in this inner product form. So this is what we want to securely compute. We do not want to reveal the values, we just want to reveal the inner product. Okay, so yeah, we brought it to this inner product of a secret values and public values, and the way we do it is very simple. We first compute, but do not reveal, we cannot reveal it yet, the pointwise product of this vector with this public vector, the pointwise product of this with this, and we add them up. So if you look at the result, you get a single vector such that the sum of the entries on this vector is the inner product that we want. So how do we reveal only the sum of the entries in a vector? We'll just add random vector whose entries add up to zero. And this we can generate cheaply by having the clients contribute their parts. So this is similar to how we generated other forms of secret randomness. Okay, so this is basically it. I gave you all of the building blocks of the protocol. And in terms of asymptotic complexity, it gives you what I promised. In the case that the field is small, this is relevant for Boolean circuits. We have to multiply the computational overhead. We need to repeat the test statistical security many times to amplify soundness, so we get some computational overhead. Okay. How do we boost security threshold? I will not explain it in detail, but this is the technique of Bracha that I mentioned. And the idea is to use a linear number of committees where each committee is of constant size. Think of picking N committees of servers where each committee has 20 servers. Okay, and let's say that we have 33% of corrupted party. What can I tell about these committees? I can say that almost all of them have less than one third corrupted parties. Right, because they're random, so you can think of a random committee as sampling. Right, we expect a random committee to have 33%, which is less than one third. Okay, so Chernoff bounds tells me that almost all of them, more than 99% of them for sufficiently large n, will have less than one third, which is slightly more than 0.33 corrupted parties. So now if we emulate the role of each server, we virtualize each server by a different committee, we are in a situation that if we run the BGW protocol on each constant size committee, this only has constant overhead because it's BGW run with a constant set of parties. Now we're in a situation that the virtual servers, 99% of them are honest, are good. Okay, so this is really a pretty generic idea and it brings us close to the threshold. This idea is also of the do not try it at home genre. Okay, so it's good for asymptotics, it's not good for concrete efficiency. We have better ways of getting close to the threshold without applying this technique, but it works asymptotically. Okay, let me mention that we can use constant size fields for Boolean circuits using algebraic geometry codes. And we can use, so far I explained the easy case where the number of clients is constant. What if we're in the standard MPC model or if you have as many clients or servers? Then things need to be done a bit differently. We need better ways of generating random secrets. So we use some simple randomness extraction techniques for that. We need the circuit. Now we want to evaluate a single big circuit. We don't have somebody to arrange the values for us. It's not easy in this setting. We need to convert the circuit into a SIMD-friendly form, which can be done with logarithmic overhead using routing networks such as Banish network. And if we do all these tricks, we get the same result as before in the standard MPC model or with many clients with a slight price. And we can even do it with perfect security if we use some packed version of the BGW VSS using bivariate polynomial that Gilad described, or alternatively, a notion called hyperinvertible matrices due to Berliova and Hirt. Okay, so to conclude, honest majority MPC protocols are efficient. In fact, they're also useful. And the communication and computation are almost as good as we can hope, given what we're really stuck on. It's a bit tautological, but it seems like the barriers are kind of fundamental. And we have these two big questions. One is breaking the circuit size communication barrier in the information theoretic setting. The question is open even for passive security, as long as the number of parties is big. And the second question, which is really intriguing, I thought about it quite a lot, is getting constant computational overhead for malicious parties, sorry, even for semi-honest parties when the security threshold is big. So doing something other than using Shamir or a similar type of error correcting code. So that's it.